Ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be able to introduce to you a gentleman who needs no introduction. What did you say your name was? Mr. Buckley and I have been comrades in arms for the conservative cause for 4 decades. In fact, it has been almost precisely 40 years since we first met at the home of John Clark in East Lansing. John Clark, whose body now lies in an unmarked grave in Cameron, Missouri. And there's been a curious parallel and correspondence in our lives. We both served in the Army during the Second World War. We both were college instructors for some 4 years until we left for more decent occupations. And the first book of each of us was published in 1951. With an interesting coincidence, God and Man at Yale by Mr. Buckley and Randolph of Roanoke by me. And I'm happy to report that both those books still are in print. We both published books exposing the errors of the institutions of higher learning from which we were graduated as bachelors of arts. And we both have published books in academic freedom, of which, however, we don't take exactly the same view. Both of us founded magazines in the late 50s, Mr. Buckley's National Review, which has done more to defend the permanent things in American politics and society than any other publication in the history of this country, and my quarterly Modern Age, founded in the same year. We both commenced writing syndicated newspaper columns purely by coincidence in 1962, and Mr. Buckley has continued with that ever since. 30 years. Think of 30 years of that agony. It's terribly exacting, especially having to answer all the letters you get. That's worse than writing the column. And Mr. Buckley, with really heroic determination, has gone on for 3 decades writing a frequent column. I gave up after 13 years. It's too much. Hold it up then. Well, we were both active in the primary and presidential campaigns of Senator Barry Goldwater 2 years later, and still later, of course, in those of Ronald Reagan. We both run for public office in the middle 60s. Mr. Buckley was far more successful with his syndicated column, but I was far more successful in practical politics. I was twice elected and successively to the office I desired, and in each case I got 100% of the vote. You can't do much better than that. Mr. Buckley fought hard, but he got only a little more than 30% of the vote for his office. He was running for mayor of New York, and I was running for the Justice of the Peace of Morton Township. Both of us have received presidential medals, and what is more significant, perhaps, both of us have published exactly 30 books each. Isn't that a coincidence? 30 each. And among those books, in his case and in mine, are several romances. So we've written not merely political works and historical works, but fiction as well. Both of us, over 4 decades, have delivered literally thousands of lectures, especially on college campuses. And I'm sure that Mr. Buckley, like myself, has spoken on, well, between 1,500 and 2,000 college campuses. Now, this sounds rather like a wicked conspiracy, of course, but there has been no collusion. We live far apart, we visited each other at our respective homes from time to time, and we correspond sporadically, but we never plan any great campaign to convert the American public to conservative views. What has happened is by coincidence or providence. Arthur Kessler says there's no such thing as coincidence, so it must be by providence. Our work has been carried on simultaneously. But we have our disagreements, especially on 2 points. The first of those is television. Mr. Buckley has been a very good influence on television, as had Dr. Kennedy. So I exempt him from my harsh indictment. But I agree with Mr. Buckley's friend and my friend, Malcolm Muggeridge, that television is the ruination of the human race, that we have no hope now. All is over. Mr. Muggeridge said so at my house once, and I looked like an angel of cheerfulness by his side. But I concluded he's quite right. There is no hope now that television has triumphed, and Mr. Buckley's endeavors and those of Dr. Kennedy will not save us from the ruin which depends. Nevertheless, once upon a time, Mr. Buckley phoned me and asked me to write a television page for every number of National Review. I was horror-struck. What could he think of me? What degradation did he intend for me? I promptly refused. And not long thereafter, I learned that my daughter Monica, who's present here tonight, was surreptitiously watching television in the foretower of our Italianate house. On learning that, I climbed the ladder to the tower, found the set, and defenestrated it, flung it out the window, so it'll never be used again. Well, now we disagree on that on television. The second disagreement we have is about the situation of National Review. National Review's trouble is it is situated in the center of Manhattan. Now, years ago, when Mr. Buckley was just planning to found National Review, Henry Regnery told him that the worst possible place to publish a conservative magazine would be New York City. And very true that is. What is more, our old friend T.S. Eliot said that the worst form of expatriation for an American writer is residence in New York City. And there is where Mr. Buckley caught in the heart of Manhattan. Now, I have proposed a remedy for that. Years ago, or decades ago, the English man of letters, Wyndham Lewis, asked me to explain American conservatism. He was blind then. We were talking in his rather gloomy studio apartment in Notting Hill in London. And so I gave him some principles of American conservatism. And he asked, well, give me the name of an American conservative city. I said, oh, Grand Rapids. He said, why Grand Rapids? I said, well, twice during the Roosevelt era, Grand Rapids was the only sizable American city that voted against Franklin Roosevelt. That's true. Twice. The most conservative big town in America. And so I have a remedy for Mr. Buckley's imprisonment there in the heart of Gotham. The thing to do is to shift or translate National Review from the decrepit building which it occupies at 150 East 35th Street to the heart of Grand Rapids. More particularly to the Waters Building. That splendid, restored structure of commodious, beautiful, great halls, charming place, which is occupied in part by the Acton Institute. He'll be welcomed there by his friends of the Acton Institute and by all citizens of Grand Rapids. They'll give him a warm welcome when the offices of National Review are entrenched there. And I'm sure a similarly warm welcome tonight as he addresses us on certain reflections on religion. Mr. Buckley.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Kirk, Father Rico, Ms. Parkinson, Mr. Mitchell. I'm very happy to be in your company and to receive this invitation from Russell Kirk, which I will take very seriously. There is the slight problem, which is the proximity of Minnesota to Michigan. The only reason I say this is because I remember on election day in 1984, when the television, those of you who look at it, revealed that Ronald Reagan had received the vote of every state in the Union, with the exception of Minnesota, I sent him a telegram. And I said, perhaps you will be comforted by my recollection that in 1956, Adlai Stevenson had a stunning upset in Minnesota in the primary to Estes Kefauver. Raymond Moley was asked the next day how could he account for this upset, to which he replied, "Did you ever try to tell a joke in Minneapolis?" Obviously, jokes work well here, which disposes of that problem. Besides which, I want you to know that I made strenuous efforts to be here on time. I left a breakfast at which Mr. Gorbachev was answering questions. To be sure, it had begun at 8:15, and I didn't leave until 10. But it was, it reminded me, since he was just warming up, of the criticism made during the 30s by the British scholar who said the trouble with socialism is that it uses up too many evenings. I've been very, very carefully instructed that I am addressing tonight an audience mostly of Christians who are, however, varied in your denominational commitments. It has frequently resulted, I know from my reading and from my experience, that when one addresses an audience that includes a half dozen or more denominations, one is expected to give a very wide berth to any position that might possibly suggest the speaker's own formal affiliations. The difficulty with that approach is that as often as not, the speaker ends up giving even Jesus Christ a wide berth. I've not come all this way to engage in such circumlocutions, besides which, to do so would cause Professor Russell Kirk to leave the stage, pleading a need to exorcise the ghosts at Piety Hill. I've learned both from experience and from whatever one chooses to call that knowledge that comes from maturing years that to offend Russell Kirk is both tactically unwise and philosophically foolish. He is my good friend, just to begin with, and my most revered mentor. I desire very much to bring you some satisfaction from the little acres I intend to explore that you might put down as a velleity, i.e. lightly expressed wish. But if I would leave here tonight having disappointed Russell Kirk, I would commit suicide. Now, suicide is, in my denomination, a mortal sin. Have I offended anybody? If there is... If there is anyone out there whose faith does not decree that suicide is sinful, why, that person is free not to seek to deter me if he spots me with a pistol pointed at my head after Russell Kirk has disavowed me. What I've just said suggests the awful uses of temptation. I can think of some very orthodox Christians who, were I to depart this vale of tears by my own hand, would ask the Lord to weigh my sinfulness against their good fortune. In any event, let me say for the record that I'm most enthusiastic and encouraged by the work of the Acton Institute and Father Sirico, so much so that I have violated a contractual covenant I have with the Board of Directors of National Review, which is over 30 years old, namely never, ever to speak except for the financial benefit of National Review. Whatever I have to offer is yours free at the expense of National Review. I suppose I should at least insert this plug for the magazine. to which I have indeed devoted a lifetime's work and which continues to emphasize the same postulates that animate the Acton Institute. I poked around recently at the background of the late Archbishop Fulton Sheen, whose name has come up here, and this instantly brings up memories of that great Christian ecumenical figure. His television performances for several years had most of Christian America transfixed. Those of you as ancient as I will perhaps remember that in the early 50s he competed against Milton Berle, the famous comedian, who after 6 months of subordinate ratings announced that he was going to fire all his writers and substitute for them Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. I had a collateral professional relationship with Bishop Sheen because the man who persuaded him to launch a syndicated column also handled the column of that I wrote myself. He seldom saw the Archbishop, but that didn't seem to make any difference. Harry Amrock told me that in dealing with Bishop Sheen, he learned immediately that he was dealing with the supreme professional. Columnist Sheen, for instance, never missed a deadline, and when he went off on his extensive trips, sometimes for weeks at a time, he would calculate the number of columns that would be needed between the day he left and the day he returned, say 8 or 10 or 12 or even 20. And on the day before his departure, the bishop's secretary would arrive at the syndicate's office with all the columns neatly typed out, exactly correct as to length, always readable, orthodox, inspirited, and inspiring. Here is a singular advantage, as Russell Kirk will agree, for the columnist dealing with religious themes. There are no secular distractions to worry about. No primaries or elections were pending in the world Fulton Sheen wrote about, the consequences of which he was unfamiliar with. All quarrels about the balance of powers had long since been settled. No energumens were subtly absorbing authority or usurping power, and so nothing ever caught Fulton Sheen off balance, or if so, we were not apprised of it. He absorbed even Vatican II without a trace of apparent difficulty. He was a man of great precision. I heard him speak only once. It was at the annual celebration of the Sons of St. Patrick. He had once or twice been quoted to the effect that he could not understand it when a speaker used notes, let alone a text. Quotes, if the speaker cannot memorize his own words, how can he hope that others will retain his message in memory? He was quoted as saying. The implied syllogism, by the way, is defective. Abraham Lincoln spoke from texts. That evening, addressing 700 people who, during the cocktail and dinner hours, had engaged wholeheartedly in the social custom especially associated with Irish conviviality, Bishop Sheen elected to speak on the theme of piety and laughter. The text was rich in illustration, and in a matter of minutes, his audience had become his trained chorus, laughing exactly when he willed that we should do so, laughing for exactly as long as he expected that we should, in exactly the pitch he desired. His predecessor at the podium was the governor of the state of New York. The contrast between their oratorical skills was especially accentuated when Archbishop Sheen remarked that that which distinguishes the Irishman from others is that the Irishman, quote, blows his own nose, makes his own love, and writes his own speeches. It was obvious at whose expense among the luminaries on the dais the audience would laugh on hearing those words. Nelson Rockefeller smiled stoically, his eyes half shut. I remember that Russell Kirk's dear friend and mine, Bill Casey, leaned over to me and whispered, I bet Rockefeller's thinking he qualifies in at least 2 of the 3 Irish categories. And I can't forget that at the end of the 20-minute oration, his arms stretched out to his side. Slowly, Fulton Sheen turned them palm upward and then raised them decisively above his head. With them in perfect harmony, we rose, all 700 of us, synchronizing exactly with the final line of Bishop Sheen's peroration. As his hands completed their upward glide, the crowd rose on its feet to give him not a standing ovation upon the completion of his talk, but a rising ovation as he completed his talk. Leonard Bernstein never controlled an orchestra and chorus more completely than Fulton Sheen, his audience. It is an ineffaceable memory. He came to firing line One day, after lecturing at Grand Rapids, under whose auspices I can't remember, remembering only that our office needed to make for him the logistical arrangements, which were complicated, he was with me to participate in a panel to discuss the most recent translation of Augustine's Confessions, Tell the Truth. I remember only one thing he said on that occasion, which was that Byron had once remarked that Augustine taught me vices I never knew existed. On one other occasion, on fine land, Fulton Sheen was commenting during the high moments of libertinism that followed the incursion into Cambodia and Vatican II. I remarked apropos of something rather a point of obvious interest to all Christian faiths, namely, that discipline within the Catholic Church struck me as progressively lax. I asked him for what offenses did he believe the Church was correct to excommunicate. He replied, for the desecration of the Blessed Sacrament. Surely, I said, there are other capital offenses. To this he replied that it was for God to judge and that God was all merciful. I know that everyone associated with the Acton Institute can agree on that proposition, or at least can hope that it's true. And so we found ourselves awash, as so often happens to reflective Christians, on one of the eternal mysteries of Christianity, the doggedly invisible nexuses between the God of mercy and the God of rectitude. I don't remember that I pursued the point. Fulton Sheen, when appearing before a camera, was to listen to, not to argue with. Max Beerbohm confided to me when I was not yet 21 that the Socratic manner is not a game at which two people can play. I told Falserico when 1 year ago he invited me to give this lecture that I would accept his generous invitation, in part because several years ago I made a commitment to a trade publisher to write a book on why I am a Catholic, 9/10 of which book will obviously center on the theme why I am a Christian. When this invitation was tendered, I knew that I would have begun reading for a book I must complete by next summer. That reading is at this point merely nibbled at, so abundant is the literature. It's dismaying to reflect that even if I were to give it the whole of my time, I could not hope to read it all, let alone to master it before the Reaper arrives solemnly to stay my hand. I can then only invite you to travel with me along a bypath or two on which I have happened in the early stages of my inquiry, whose keel for me has been the postulate that Christianity does not ask us to believe anything that is contrary to reason. I've been much taken by a complaint of Father Ronald Knox, voiced in his published exchanges with Arnold Lund. Perhaps you are aware, some of you, of the book Difficulties, published in 1933, in which Father Knox, a Catholic convert from the Anglican faith, undertook to try to cope with the, quote, difficulties Arnold Lund singled out as standing in the way of his own conversion to the Catholic faith. In the course of explaining one point, Father Knox, later, of course, Monsignor Knox, said with some exasperation that he could never understand why so many people prefer vagueness to mystery. Sometimes no attempt at explanation is preferable to attenuated explanations. There are ever so many reasons to believe in God. I remember reading many years ago and judging dispositive on the subject the remark with which a British scientist dismissed a skeptic's importunities 100 years ago. I find it easier, he said, to believe in God than to believe that Hamlet was deduced from the molecular structure of a mutton chop. The great postulate that God exists and that he is omnipotent and omniscient is our intellectual anchor and the fountainhead of our epistemology. The difficulties one then comes up with are best dealt with not by vague explanations, but by acknowledging them as mysteries. I know that God exists, but I haven't any idea why he permits animals to suffer. Moreover, I think the exercise futile to seek rationales that are seen after laborious endeavor to be sustained by sophistry, these being the inevitable termini of minds whose powers to reason abounded. Common law instructs us that Hermann Goering had to have an advocate at Nuremberg. It doesn't follow that we must fashion a defense for every delinquency of nature. Given the limited vocabulary available to rational man, we are incapable of bearing such a burden. Early in March, 2 months ago, a week ending with an old friend in the English countryside near London, we got news in the morning newspaper of an earthquake in East Turkey, an earthquake that killed some 400 men, women, and children. Instinctively, never mind how often the newspapers bring in news of that character, never mind how often newspapers fail to ask or even suggest the query, I found myself asking, God being omnipotent, why does he permit suffering so manifestly unrelated to human misbehavior? The reflective mind gropes for air, a little time to come up with something. On the other hand, you find yourself thinking the sudden death of 400 human beings as a result of an earthquake isn't any more a manifestation of divine disorder than the death from cancer of 400 people scattered about the globe. If everything that happens serves a divine purpose, is it possible for thinking man to identify the point of intersection between that earthquake and God's superintendence of human and natural affairs? Is it fruitful to attempt to guess what could be God's purpose in permitting the earthquake, let alone to presume to reason to God's purpose in permitting it? Is the best we can do with phenomenon to set it down as a rogue act of nature, unrelated to any plan of God, and merely incidental to the earthly organism he constructed and then loosed? I'm reminded of the simple clarifier cited by Ronald Locke. I do not think, he said, there is any getting over the force of Butler's argument in his analogy, that if we had been set down to build this world according to our own specifications, it would not have been the world as we know it. We need then, I think, to concede against that strain of human pride that seeks to know everything, only this, that some things are not knowable, and that therefore it serves our purpose to frustrate frustration by refusing to activate it, by inordinate attempts to divine divine purpose. All that Christian theology tells us is that we are never asked to believe anything that contradicts reason, which is very different from telling us that we can reason to an understanding of all earthly phenomena. We are required then to believe only this, that it is not contrary to reason that a random earthquake would devastate a little town in Turkey. We are permitted to wonder whether, mutatis mutandis, that town is a contemporary Sodom and Gomorrah. But if that were so, ought not the reason for its destruction to be made evident as a part of God's design? That release from understanding the reason for all of God's movements would seem to confirm that school of theological thought that absolves man of any need to love God. It would be most unreasonable of the church to demand the love of God as an essential condition for escaping hell, Father George Terrell remarked some time before he was excommunicated. For the love of God is the luxury of a few happy and imaginative temperaments. In the lump, man was not created nor designed for the love of God in that mystical sense, but for the love of man. God, Arnold Lunn added, has the right to demand obedience, but not love. The God of the random earthquake, as one might here put it, cannot expect universal love. The love of God is a cultivated refinement with some, for others an intuition that derives perhaps primarily from the fear of God and a sense of our dependence on him. Some Christians brought up on prescriptive emotional and rational impulses. I think of a God to be feared as the dispenser of eternal punishment and to be revered as the vessel of deliverance from them. It is a common psychological phenomenon that those whom we fear we can go to love, even as Ivan the Terrible was loved, and for that matter, Joseph Stalin. In slightly altered circumstances, they call this the Stockholm syndrome. The love of God issues from our gratitude for the special blessings we have, and even for workaday blessings we take for granted. The conventional grace recited before beginning a meal cedes to our Lord the credit for furnishing the food we eat. In a more truncated form than in the eloquent benediction we heard tonight, bless us, O Lord, for those thy gifts which we are about to receive from thy bounty through Christ our Lord. Even as we are sometimes trained and sometimes spontaneously inclined to thank God routinely for everything we enjoy, however matter-of-factly day by day, not only food but shelter, medicine, the protections given to us by our parents, our friends, our teachers. Yet this ascription to God of everything we come upon that is utilitarian runs into rational obstacles unrelated to the problem of God of random earthquakes. I ran into that problem early in my life when my music teacher, intending only an amusing anecdote, spoke to me of the 15-year-old boy who undertook to cultivate a patch of earth alongside a slum dwelling in which he and his parents lived, to which end he devoted many hours, day after day, month after month. In due course, the little acre bloomed with flowers and vegetables. The neighboring priest, stopping by one afternoon, remarked to him, "Joseph, that is a beautiful garden that you and God produced," bringing from the boy the blurted response, "You should have seen it when just God was taking care of it." The sequence here brings to mind not only the question, so to speak, of the division of labor between God and man, but also the question Arnold Lunn put to Monsignor Knox: what is the point in glorifying God when God, by the nature of things, already enjoys infinite glory? God made that earth from which young Joseph worked fertile. From his infinity we cannot subtract, to his radiance we cannot add, and so we ask the question, are such prayers as are directed to glorifying God supererogatory? In which connection we're tempted to ask, is there in such a prayer a factor of sycophancy? Consider this passage from St. Augustine. I selected it because it is more merely than cant adoration, building as it does on the great paradoxes that attach to God the Creator, and I select it also because it was framed by the mind and lips of someone at once a great metaphysician and a great poet. St. Augustine wrote, "What art thou then, my God? What but the Lord God? For who is Lord but the Lord? Or who is God save our God, most highest, most good, most potent, most omnipotent, most merciful, yet most just, most hidden, yet most present, most beautiful, yet most strong, stable, yet incomprehensible, unchangeable, yet all-changing, never new, never old, all-renewing and bringing age upon the ground, and they know it not, ever working, ever at rest, still gathering, yet nothing lacking, supporting, filling, and overspreading, creating, nourishing, and maturing, seeking, yet having all things. Thou lovest without passion, art jealous without anxiety, repentest, yet grievest not, art angry, yet serene, changest thy works, thy purpose unchanged, receivest again what thou findest, yet didst never lose, never in need, yet rejoicing in gains, never covetous, yet exacting usury. Thou receivest over and above that thou mayest owe, and who hath aught that is not thine? Thou payest debts, owing nothing, remittest debts, losing nothing. And what have I now said, my God, my life, my holy joy? Or what saith any man when he speaks of thee? Yet woe to him that speaketh not, since the mute or even the most eloquent. It is not for the mind bent upon rational exercise to examine such language. It is rather for the worshipful mind, for the mind that has experienced something once described to me by Malcolm Muggeridge with some success. But the rational mind, guarding only against any infraction of the law that faith will not call on him to violate reason, approaches such prayer in a different register from the mind at the laboratory. Consider the prayer I read at chapel in Stoner. Later in the same morning that I read the news of the earthquake in Turkey, that little chapel where I heard Mass is situated about 100 feet from the hidden recess of the great house in which Edmund Campion hid from the Elizabethan militia, commanded to find him and to bring him to the Tower of London to answer for the treasonable activity of distributing the sacraments under the Catholic dispensation. He would be tried and found guilty, and Father Campion, the former protege of Queen Elizabeth, would submit to 4 days of crippling torture before being hanged, drawn, and quartered. So in that little venerable chapel where Campion prayed, the congregation reads from the preface a Eucharistic prayer. Father in heaven, it is right that we should give you thanks and glory, you alone are God, living and true. Through all eternity you live in unapproachable light, source of life and goodness. You have created all things to fill your creatures with every blessing, and lead all men to the joyful vision of your light. A countless hosts of angels stand before you to do your will. They look upon your splendor and praise you night and day. United with them and in the name of every creature under heaven, we praise your glory as we say, holy, 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 Lord God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. It is right that we should give you thanks and glory. It suggests that there are those who believe that it is not right that we should give him thanks and glory. Why would some people be reluctant to give him thanks and glory? Well, one reason might be that they believe in an omnipotent God, and they can't understand why only a few hours ago he would cause an earthquake in a little town in Turkey, or if he did not cause it, they do not understand why he failed to prevent it. They ask, is such a God indeed the God to whom we owe thanks and glory, the God who permitted such random violence? Yes, our God is the source of life and goodness who has created all things. But did he not also create that geological malformation that caused life and goodness sharply to end for 400 of his creatures? Since God is perfect, we cannot dismiss, can we, the Turkish event as divine oversight. It must have been divine intention, or if not that, something that happened under his dispensation. And if God does not give us the analytical power to descry reason in that earthquake in Turkey, then indeed, as the prayer says, he is an unapproachable light. But why then do we say that he illuminates the thought of the world with his life and goodness? And inasmuch as countless hosts of angels stand before him to do his will, why was not one angel dispatched to Turkey to appease the rest of geological substratum? A host of angels looks upon his splendor and praises him night and day, but why does he seek praise? Why does he desire praise? Why does he desire praise? And indeed, why does he deserve praise? If according to the laws that are given to men to reason from, men must condemn aimless terror, why not condemn terror when done by the hand of the Lord, or when done by inanimate creations of the Lord, even as we condemn aimless terror when done by the hands of man? And isn't the question necessarily raised, does it not demean these creatures of God to seek to lift our poor voices in praise through that hailstorm of praise with which the elements themselves storm the throne of heaven? And are we not creatures of God trained to revere the cardinal virtues of prudence, to resist gluttony? Haven't we cause to wonder why no thought is given to the scope of divine licentiousness in soliciting praise from us. Are we, as Christian believers, become in our prayers a tribe of lily gilders? Or does the problem lie in the word to praise? Exactly what is it that we would do? To praise is to extol, commend, admire the subject's virtues or talents. But how can this be applicable when the subject is already the essence of virtue, whose talents are undefinable, even as infinity is immeasurable? Doesn't it run the risk of belittling God to proceed as though to praise him were to embellish him? Praise him? If to praise him is to augment him, then he is not perfect. If praise cannot augment him, how can he be susceptible to praise? And if he is not, why do we go through the motions? And just what does it mean to praise his glory? One praises only that which is created or engendered, whether by God or by man, whether a painting or a sunset. But God didn't create his glory, because God always was. Is there a problem deep within some Christian prayers? Do they summon human resources to ends beyond human competence? We arrive finally at the question, how reasonably can man be expected to praise that God which we have agreed to call the God of the random earthquake? Here's one man's answer. Why did this longing for faith assail me? Malcolm Muggeridge repeated the question I had asked him. Insofar as I can point to anything, it has to do with this profession, which both you and I have followed, of observing what's going on in the world and attempting to report and comment thereon, because that particular occupation gives one a very heightened sense of the sheer fantasy of human affairs, the sheer fantasy of power and of the structures that men construct out of power, and therefore gives one an intense, overwhelming longing to be in contact with reality. And so you look for reality, and you try this and try that, and ultimately you arrive at the conclusion, this is a great oversimplification, he says, that reality is a mystery. The heart of reality is a mystery. I asked him, why should this mystery lead to Christian belief? He said quickly, because it leads you to God. It's when you are aware of the cloud of unknowing that you begin to know. And what you know, to simplify and put it very simply, is God. That's the beginning of faith for me. I asked whether he was engaging in deduction, and if so, had he left no room for grace? The deductive process, he said, is the means, but faith is the motive force that takes you there. It's exactly like, Bill, it's exactly like falling in love. You see another human being, and for some extraordinary reason, you're in a state of joy and ecstasy over that person, but the driving force that enables you to express that and to bring it into your life is love. Without love, it's nothing. It passes. It's the same with seeking reality. And there, the driving force we call faith. It's a very difficult thing to define, actually. I pressed him on to speak of the God of the random earthquake, to tell us about mystery. The use of the word mystery, I said, has been much disdained by skeptics as too easy a way to account for some of the hideous anomalies of history. The Holocaust, to take something on a macrocosmic scale, the six-year-old girl who dies of leukemia on another scale. Isn't it probably the case that such anomalies as these do more to encourage skepticism than anything else in the divine order? I don't think, he said, they encourage skepticism. He said that wrongly, I think, but he persisted. On the contrary, I would say that they encourage belief, as a matter of fact. What they do is they present a dilemma to which reason provides no answer. And you can only find that answer through what is called mysticism, or indeed through what Blake called the imagination, which is art. So what I asked, did Blake mean by imagination? He meant, putting it in one of his very favorite sayings, he said, they ever must believe a lie who see with, not through the eye. He means by imagination seeing through the eye, seeing into the meaning of things rather than seeing things. I asked how imagination would have seen through to the meaning of the death of a six-year-old child, because, he said, he would see in it There are some lines of his which I just can't quote exactly from memory, but it's something like, joy and woe are woven fine, a clothing for the soul divine. In other words, suffering, affliction, disappointment, failure, all those things are an integral part of the drama of our human existence. And without them, there'd be no drama. Let me tell you, he said, what will be a simple parable, which I've often thought of. Some very humane, rather simple-minded old lady sees the play King Lear performed, and she is outraged that a poor old man should be so humiliated, made to suffer so. And in the eternal shade, she meets Shakespeare, and she says to him, what a monstrous thing to make that poor old man go through all of that. And Shakespeare says, yes, I quite agree, it was very painful. And I could have arranged for him to take a sedative at the end of Act One, but then, ma'am, there would have been no play. Do you see my point? Yes and no, I said. After all, King Lear might have preferred the sedative. But then, he said, he would have been a cowardly man, and of course he did in fact have to go through that suffering in order to understand why there had to be a play. And of course, in that marvelous speech of his, one of my favorite things in all of Shakespeare, when he to Cordelia says, come, let's away to prison, you know, and take upon us the mystery of things. It's a beautiful phrase, isn't it? It expresses exactly what I mean. This affliction has to be. And that, of course, is why one is drawn irresistibly as a Western European to the Christian faith and to Christ, because this is a central point, the cross. I too deem this the central point for Christ to reflect upon. The God who imposed upon himself the torture of the cross has never asked man to suffer more than he suffered for us. Yes, we know why Christ suffered, but it is never obvious, not even discernible, why certain others suffer, King Lear, the residents of the little village in Turkey, the millions of victims of Nazism and communism. Yes, their suffering gives us that sense of the august nobility of life of which Muggeridge speaks. But the price is very high, high by our understanding, by our reckoning. And so we ask ourselves again, ought we to attempt to understand? Fulton Sheen once wrote that the church is accused of being the enemy of reason. As a matter of fact, she is the only one who believes in it. Using her reason in the Council of the Vatican, she officially went on record in favor of rationalism and declared against the mock humility of the agnostic and the sentimental faith of the fideists that human reason by its own power can know something besides the content of test tubes and retorts, and that working on mere sensible phenomena, it can soar even to the hid battlements of eternity. Yes, and the great thinkers have satisfied us that reason can lead us to God, and that reason leads us also to know his attributes. But mysteries remain. Again, in the volume of their correspondence, Knox made the point, the trouble with you, Knox complained, as with all moderns, is, as I say, that you prefer vagueness to mystery. People talk as if definition was an attempt to abolish mystery, but actually, it's the other way around. Theological mystery depends for its existence upon the hard outlines of definition. Thus, if you assert by definition that in that which you see before you the accidents remain those of bread, but the substance is that of the body of Christ, you have mystery. You have confessed the inadequacy of your reason to understand a reconciliation which is nevertheless a necessary one. But if you say, all I know is that Christ is here, that is not mystery but vagueness. Your statement may mean anything or next to nothing. Your mind has nothing to bite on, and you are left with a merely emotional attitude. So let's agree on the mysteries. We have seen a fine tabulation of them done by St. Augustine. But in agreeing that that is what they are, we do not abandon reason. We simply recognize its limitations. We know that God is omniscient, but that he cannot disturb the basic framework of reason. He does not have the power to decree that two and two make five. We reason to the existence of God, and it is revealed to us that his son was the incarnation, and that such was his love of us that he endured a torture very nearly singular in pain and unique in its aspect, the God of hosts mutilated by his own creatures, whom he dies forgiving and loving. The Fulton Sheen, who continues to attract so much ecumenical attention, received as a very young man the highest academic honor the University of Louvain grants, the first ever given to an American student. He elected to spend his years teaching and preaching and writing. He recorded that he never doubted the course he elected to pursue as a full-time servant of God, and he left 70 volumes in which he explored the faith he practiced. But he was never tempted to untangle the mysteries of the faith, because if he had done so, the faith would have decomposed, like a witch come into contact with water. The mysteries prompt us to praise the Lord against the tug of mere reason, yet praise even the Lord under whose surveillance we have pestilence and starvation and wars and genocide. The unheavenly city of God is beset by many afflictions, and we cannot know what precisely is their etiology, knowing only that at the beginning man was sinful, that in the plenitude of his experience on earth, redemption came through the incarnation, and that until the end comes for us all, we will suffer even for reasons we cannot know, even as Job suffered, but that in the end we will know the transfiguration, and then, but not until then, we will know why our instincts, intuitive and learned, have been to praise the Lord. It is difficult, supremely so, to communicate, or rather to commute between those cities in which the human mind is competent to transact the problems at hand, even when they are problems of the highest gravity, intellectual, moral, and aesthetic, and the city of God. But these minds, because hubris is always with us, seek also to apply their limited resources to understand other questions which are beyond our competence. That exercise can breed frustration, and the nature of that frustration, I think, was wonderfully caught in a few paragraphs in which all that is observed and all that is thought are entirely pedestrian in character. They are the opening lines in Bruce Marshall's novel, Father Malachy's Miracle. They tell us in the form of a parable what are the boundaries we should not attempt to penetrate. A fat man climbed into the same compartment as the little clergyman, a fat man with a face that was so red and pouchy that it looked like a bladder painted to hit other people over the head with at an Italian carnival. He sat down, or rather threw himself down, in the corner opposite the priest and began to read a pink paper in which the doings of horses and erotic young women were chronicled at length. He was followed by a middle-aged woman who had a peaky, shiny nose with a funny little dent in the middle, and whose hat was one of those amorphous black affairs which would have been at any moment out of fashion in any country. The priest was distracted from his meditation. It was impossible, he told himself with a wry little metal smile, to think competently of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Ghost, proceeding from both, with such a bulging red face in front of him and such a peaky, peering woman placing her parcels here and there and everywhere. How hard it was here below, and with the material and the temporal crowding out the spiritual and the eternal, to love one's neighbor. How hard and yet how necessary. For the soul behind that bulging red face had been redeemed by Christ just as surely as had his own, and our blessed Lord, while he hung on the cross, had seen the funny little dent in the middle of that peaky, peering woman's nose just as clearly as he had seen the broadened visage of Pope Pius XI. And so merciful was he, loved it just as much. And yet it was difficult to imagine bulge or dent in heaven unless among the many mansions there were one which had 1/10 beatific vision and 9/10 Isle of Man. Of course, if it came to that point, it was difficult to imagine the majority of contemporary humanity in any paradise which did not syncopate St. Gregory and whose eternal sands were without striped bathing tents and casinos. He closed his eyes again. If he must love his neighbor, he would love him without looking at him. He closed his eyes, and not only did he close them, but he kept on repeating the reflex action in his brain, so that, with the bulging red face and the peaky, peering woman, away went the compartment, the train, the station, the world. And as Scotland went swinging after Scandinavia, and Spain came scampering after, and Australia flew to join the stars, he was alone with God. A great nothingness was before him, a great nothingness that was something, a great nothingness that was all, and in the warm freedom from the tangible, he drew his Savior and was absorbed by him. Reflection on such a passage reminds us how fruitful thought can be, even when conducted within the prescribed territories, beyond which Fulton Sheen never trespassed, as he gave to the Lord that which was his with a full heart and a mind that honored its own limitations and the Creator's unchallengeable authority to make those limitations. Those of you who are here under the auspices of the Acton Institute are graced to believe, and that huge superstructure of anomalies, in its wonderful ways, adds to the comprehensive magnitude of our faith. And so it is that with confidence we praise our Lord and thank him even for such attenuated blessings as you have just now experienced.